Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another edition of The Classic Quest with your boy HSR.
Yo, what's good? It's your boy Chris Chrome.
And Mommy.
Hey. And as usual, your lovely lady friend, Bonnie.
Lovely.
Yeah, lovely is a word. So, Chris, what is the album we are doing this week?
Well, this week we got actually requested from
Armz
to do Kendrick Lamar's Good Kid, Maad City album. That is m.a.a.d for Maad.
With capital A's.
Yes, and we did the deluxe version, but didn't do the remixes because fuck that shit.
Yeah, we it's like a trend we do. We just don't do that.
So, Bonnie, when did you discover Kendrick Lamar? Last week.
It's like a running thing.
Okay, when?
I think I introduced him to you, actually.
There's no way plot that twist. You introduced me to Kendrick Lamar.
When I played you, you know the song. King Kunta.
Baby, I knew Kendrick Lamar before To Pimp a Butterfly came out.
Well, whatever. Anyways, like, we're impressed that I knew what it was.
Yes, impressed that you knew what it was.
That's different.
The same thing.
That's so different than here, babe. Kendrick.
Whatever. Like, anyways, okay. He was impressed that I had it.
Yeah,
and
it was
so
impressive.
I've always liked that song, like, since the first time I heard it. And then as for this album, like, I had heard, what are you laughing?
I'm just thinking about what you said, baby.
I love you too.
Awkward.
Anyway, yeah, as for this album, I had heard Swimming Pools before. Like, I had heard it kind of in passing, but it wasn't until, like, a couple of weeks ago that I actually was, like, kind of, like, going through some of the songs, actually, and I think you were as well, and we came across that song, and I was like, oh, yeah, I forgot about that song, and so I, like, have been listening to it all the time since, and it is such a good song.
Okay. So she discovered Kendrick at Pimp a Butterfly is what we can establish here with some
knowledge of
that one song. All right, Chris, you?
Yeah.
Well, I clearly discovered Kendrick when Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe came out and when Swimming Pools came out when it dropped. So when this album dropped, I will admit I kind of may have slept on the album, but that's my fault. But I'm glad we got to do it this week. You, Holden?
I got peer pressured into Kendrick at a certain point back in, like...
Make it sound like it's a bad thing, though.
Ironic.
Well, it was when I went to Pakistan, right? And I was talking... This was 2013. That's how I know. I was in Pakistan with my boy Jay, and he was like, bro, you gotta check out Kendrick. He's not what you think. Because to be honest, I'd heard Swimming Pools a couple of times but didn't really listen to it, and I thought it was pretty fucking bad at first. Straight up. Like, the first few times I heard it, I did not feel the song. And then I gave everything a fair chance, and I really paid attention, and then I bumped the album, like, before the deluxe version of the album had come out.
Right, right.
Or it wasn't the deluxe version. I'm sure everything had been out. And so I just listened to it once through, but, you know, I'm not really so much into all the skits and stuff or finishing songs usually, so I ended up cherry-picking the ones I liked, and, you know, this was actually exciting. This was, like, the first one we reviewed, I think, in the entire show where... I actually really like this album. Like, I know,
and it's so
songs.
Different from everything else that we've reviewed up until this point. Or anything.
Well, don't forget. Don't forget.
It's in this
also,
fucking decade. Okay?
Yeah, like it's also a modern classic. So
like, everybody knows what this album is.
Right.
Who's probably listening to the show. Even the people who in the last episode would not have known the Queen Latifah one in that group. They know what Kendrick. My mom knows what Kendrick is. Like, everybody know Kendrick.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like
Grammys.
I was going in. Even just because I loved King Kunta so much, like, I felt like I had already, like, a bias going into this, being like, I'm really going
to
like this.
I mean,
like,
to be fair,
let's not talk so much about the album now. We got to hold up. We got a whole lot of talking.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Okay,
yeah.
So I think, fuck it, we all know Kendrick. Everybody love Kendrick. He won Grammys. He's established. He's amazing. This album was fucking around with Dre. Dre, like, met him, picked him up.
Yeah,
continuing the evolution of Dre's masterpieces he crafts, and you had interviews around how Dre,
the aftermath,
the way Dre, like, describes working with Kendrick, it's like Eminem and Snoop Dogg. When I fuck with them, they were like diamonds in the rough. I had to help them get to this thing. Kendrick walked in knowing exactly what the fuck he wanted on every fucking song, and just it was just that Kendrick is and who exactly he was.
Yeah,
and you could tell, like, it was a certain level of artisticness that this guy has that no one else does. But what'd you think of the title Good Kid, Maad City?
I mean, it was great. I think it really, it's basically like the title of, you know, it's very telling of what's kind of happening, is that he is a good kid, but he's in a kind of difficult area or the city that he's
in. Compton, in case you didn't
Compton
know.
Compton specifically. And then he has two songs in the middle of the album that are called Good Kid and Maad City, back to back, and it tells you like kind of the whole story as the whole album
really
does
the flip
as well.
Of where things start to flip and
where things really change.
Let's say
in his
like
life.
Everything that's in the first 12 songs is a story. That...
Well, no, that's what I mean. That's what I said. It's within the story. It's a story within a story.
Right. Right.
And so Shit dropped October 22nd, 2012.
Mm-hmm.
Just to throw it out there, Chris. Yep. What did you think of this 2012 banger?
I think the banger, the entire album. I think it's really cool how he went Good Kid, Maad City. It's very, actually, for me, self-explanatory. He's a good kid in a fucked up city.
Yep.
But there's a, like, I like how rappers kind of have this aggressive, badass image. And Kendrick's just like, dude, I'm just a good kid in a really fucked up city. Like, granted, a lot of rappers also talk about their hoods and stuff, but they also carry this.
There's something,
like,
there's something interesting about this title that makes it very different than a lot of the other titles in, let's say.
Right.
This is the 42nd show to hit the channel of all the ones we've touched. This is the first one that really screams concept album, right?
Like, right.
Yeah. Like, it's very much like you...
And you know it's a story, right?
Like, yeah,
you
you
know
should listen to
coming.
The whole album, and it is
and
telling you a story,
I would
like
say
each song
that
in a row.
From anecdotal, my perspective, this album was like a revival in my faith in what hip-hop could become. Because at the time, like, Wayne and Shit was starting to fall, but still on top, and... Rap was in a weird place in terms of authenticity, and then this shit came out. And honestly, when I finally did listen to it, it was like, damn, it was something else. Like, then you got the cover, which is like this, like, well, the original cover is like some photograph with everyone's eyes blacked out, and I guess a kid Kendrick.
Yeah, and then it's definitely him.
This deluxe cover that has a car, and everything looks so vintage, so back in the day. Like, you can tell this is a history
lesson.
Well,
he was born in 87, so it's like, you know, him growing up
Kendrick
in, like...
Kendrick and I are the exact-ish same age. Mm-hmm.
Dope.
I don't know. He's doing way better than I.
Jealousy!
Well.
Yeah, I'm jealous of Kendrick. And we'll get there. I'm
jealous of his success.
You know what?
Right.
But
we'll
not
save
of necessarily
we'll
what
save
he's
my
gone
jealousy
through.
For a certain song later on in this review, is all I'm going to say.
All right, well, then how about we just dive right into it then?
Yep.
All right, so let's talk about Sherane, a.k.a. Master Splinter's daughter.
Whispered in my ear, disappeared, then found her dancing. Sierra had played in the background. The parade music we made had us all wearing shades now. Cool. Where you stay? She said down the street from Dominguez High.
We like to listen to a little clip of the song before we talk about it. Mm-hmm. And I just made the connection. The little skit at the beginning where they're accepting Jesus and shit is actually a continuation of another skit we're going to get to later on in the album. Now, this is really important because it sets a tone telling you that this song is not the beginning of the story. So you're not really going to get that the first time you listen to it. And for me, it was like I literally was reviewing the album earlier today, like the formal review. So I was paying attention to all the skits and shit, and holy shit, that like brought it to a whole new level of coolness. But the little clue, so we know that this is the middle of the story at some point, right?
Yeah.
Right.
And then, it starts off with that. So actually,
it's the sinner's prayer is what they're saying, actually.
You know what just happened, though? Because I didn't really like the intro at first. I thought it was kind of annoying.
Okay.
And, like, now that I understand it better, I actually like it more. It's just really cool.
See, that's what I think. I mean, it's hard to, like, you know, stick with your, you
initial
know,
feeling.
Your initial review, I feel, even. Like, you know, the more I listen to something, the more I'm going to be like, actually, I don't really think this is that good.
We
or
all,
I'm going to really
agree,
learn to
just
love
change.
It.
When was the last time, or fuck, have we ever actually had a rapper dropping that level of layers on the concept of an album like that? Like, that's some deep
well,
shit.
Well,
yeah,
technically,
really
the only
good.
Album I remember is Ice Cube's America's Most Wanted.
Nah, dude,
no, but, like, granted, the first song was, like, him dying.
Okay,
right, and that was
yeah.
the whole. That was a concept,
yeah,
but now Kendrick just goes and drops a fucking a part of the story from the middle of it
like,
in the beginning. Like
it just it's the fact that his album placement is in and itself part of this piece of theater. It's like I said. Remember when we were talking about it, and you're like, I hated the fact that it wasn't. Nah, like Kendrick just started the album in the middle
right.
of the story.
Right, I have to agree with
is
you.
That
yep.
fucking, it's a both storytelling. So we wanted to set the tone, right? So. I mean, the beat's kind of eerie, right? It's kind of scary. And it's so theatrical, right? You can picture fucking every bar.
Yeah.
His voice is there, and he's cruising across town because he's finally, he presents us with Sherane, the sexiest girl he's ever done seen. But,
yeah.
You know, she's on that part of town and he's on this part of town. And, you know, that line is very fucking thin. And then he just kind of...
He doesn't even care.
Because he's 17 and he's horny and he's in his mom's car.
He just wants to be with her.
And he cruises down across the fucking thing and he, like, gets to where the girl is, but there's a couple of motherfuckers in hoodies there. And honestly, the end skit really hit me, right? Because I don't like skits and shit. You may have noticed that by now.
Mm-hmm.
But he gets there and he's about to, yo, what's up, Sherane? But no, they're questioning him, like, where are you from? Where are you at, my cracker? And all that shit, like, you know, and then... He just says all that stuff, like, holy shit, like, he gets there and it's almost like a setup, right? And this is just presenting the beginning of his mad city, this reality he's in. And, like, look, I don't care who you are or whatever, man, but this shit hits with a level of depth and, like, reality that I don't think I've encountered in a lot ever.
Well, again, it's also more modern, like... Hold on. I do feel a little bit that reviewing a lot of the older albums, it's yes, there's some representation or we can kind of relate somewhat, but this is a modern album. We can relate a lot more to
honestly,
a lot of
this
shit.
This has nothing granted, to do with the relative age of the album. This
fine.
Is, I'm talking about the story on the album. That is, like, you got to keep in mind.
Okay.
We're not talking about the production. Dr. Dre produced just as good as this back in 2000.
Right.
So, like, in light of that, that's not the best argument because it kind of does feel like it could have come out then.
Fine, I will give that. Different beats. I will give that.
So, what I'm saying directly here, it's the fact that right from the beginning, this like lyrics just end and it flows into like this cut scene and etc. And then his mom calls.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
And you're just like, I'm just imagining.
Well, because that happens.
Like,
right?
Every one of us has been 17 in that position where our mom called and we were up to no good. But imagine being that situation when your mom calls and literally you're about to get beat down and your mom's leaving a voicemail or your dad wants Domino's. Where the fuck's my car?
Yeah, all his dad wants is those fucking dominoes, and it's just
like
it's very funny.
And then there's the layers in this, right? Because not only are we hearing Kendrick's perspective, but he starts to tell us all, but imagine what his mom, like his mom has no idea. These parents have no idea.
Right,
yeah.
Right. Like, it's a scary thought, dude.
I
like,
don't know, like it hit me on so many
you
fronts.
Know what? I never really realized how like terrifying it is for like a parent to be like, my son's out there. To be like,
yep.
This shit's happening.
Well,
like, I don't know where
like
this
that.
Shit is.
I mean,
it's very
yeah,
scary.
But like, I don't know. Anyway, I just like, it fucking hit me. I gave this song, I give it a 4.
Yeah.
Do you know why? Because as a song, it's not as amazing as part of the story. So like, it's a weird experience. Like the intro is kind of hard to listen to musically and whatever. The beat wasn't amazing. However, it's still pretty fucking great, and I would never skip this shit. I could really listen to it. It's just not perfect.
Fair enough. I gave it a 4.
Yeah.
I gave it a 4 just because of the, like, similar reason. I mean, it's a really great message, and now that we know, now that I actually found out, thanks Holden, that the intro at the beginning of the song is technically just probably halfway of another skip from another one, it kind of really makes you think more about the emotional and meaningful message behind it, but as a track...
I know that we haven't got it there yet, but it kind of reminds me of the way he throws similar concepts around in
right.
Snoop Doggy Dogg's Doggy Style. So I propose that next week we review that. Boom, that's what's
sure.
happening.
All right,
that's happening.
Snoop Doggy Dogg.
We'll keep it in the West Side for now. All right, I want to throw one more note on it, because we talked a lot about the concept, but we kind of neglected one real subject. It's fucking rapping. So, like, it's ill. Like, his flow's on point, and he presents... It's very storytelling. It's very emotional.
I like how he does the storytelling.
His rhymes are so compounded.
They're so
ridiculous.
Powerful.
But this is one of the more boring flows on the album to me.
No. Don't worry. There's more to come.
Yeah.
All right, but anyway, listen. Bitch, don't kill my vibe.
Yep. Don't do it. Bitch, I can feel the changes. I can feel the new people around me just want to be famous.
You can see that my city found me, then put me on stages. Me, that's amazing. Someone else start. I just talked a lot.
So, if ever you're feeling really, really happy and somebody decides to turn around and fuck with your day, play this song. This is a really great song. Besides the literal aspect of bitch, don't kill my vibe, like I'm chilling, I'm vibing, it's more deep and intricate than it really is. I think. I don't know, maybe there's just literal to you, but... I do think it's very meaningful in a way where it's not just about killing the vibe.
It's a double entendre.
But it's about...
Yeah.
So it's definitely not just literal. There's
right.
Obviously a metaphorical front to it, a figurative side, if
would
you will.
Like to take it on?
It's both. Okay, because if you think about the story of it, right, it's like he's acknowledging he's a sinner and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, he's coming to, like, this sense of self-awareness. But it's both a bitch don't kill my vibe, like, don't get in my way, but also don't fuck mm-hmm. with my party, right? Mm-hmm. Like, and it's nice. I think it's more on the actually just don't fuck with who I am. Don't take advantage of me. Like, this shit, like, I don't know. I wrote down some lyrics here because I really like this song.
That's why he's, like, scared to, like, meet a girl because he's scared that he's going to get taken advantage of or that, you know, she's going to want him for the wrong reasons.
It's like, I can feel the changes. I can feel the new people around me just want to be famous. You can see that my city found me, then put me on stages. To me, that's amazing. To you, that's a quick check. With all disrespect, let me say this.
Yeah.
And I think at this part of the story, he's like coming to terms with shit, right? Like, it's a little bit's gone on.
And he's whatnot. Worth something now.
And he's basically just like, people are trying to take advantage of him and whatnot.
Well, I mean that's just kind of what happens protected. When you get famous, right? But I mean, like,
yeah.
He's just trying to ride his own wave. In a way, he's just trying to explain, like, yeah. Get the fuck off my wave, you know? Like, this is me, and if I accept you, you are free to come on. If not, then, like, you know, not. But
I think he's also meaning as well, like, I kind of got from it that he's...
I never saw the girl before.
He's competing. What do you mean?
Like, I never even thought about a woman in this entire song one time.
Oh, okay. Anyways, I thought that he was kind of competing... like in his field, like, you know, in like the rap domain, I guess,
okay.
Against people who just want to be famous and are just in it for the money.
Yeah.
And so it's not just that.
But also it's about like I relate a lot to this song.
Not actually. About the music.
So yeah. Like I wrote down in my notes and if someone wants to check after, I relate to this like Chris Chrome relates to songs, right? Like for me, it's like I've hit a point in my life where I'm doing more, right? And I'm experiencing more. And the more real I get, the more in touch with myself I get, the more I can feel the changes around me. I can see how people treat me different. I can see how I go from being an interesting whatever to a paycheck or an amusement source or something.
Everything. Like every.
And no, it's fine. I hope not. But I mean, to a degree, yeah, I'm great. But I mean... I get where he's coming from with this, and it's like people want you to change to accommodate them a lot more often than they're willing to even try to understand you. So it's like, yo, listen, bitch, don't kill my vibe. And I understand it. I respect this song. It's a fucking 5-on-5. The video is pretty boring.
Yeah.
Like, not to be a hater, it's in the church. It's very clearly themed, blah, blah, blah. And he's in a field, and... Not a lot really happens.
It's somewhat generic a little bit.
I don't know about generic. Yeah. It's a lot of
he's
imagery.
He's not what he becomes yet.
And it fits the song because he is a sinner. He's never going to... Whatever. I'm like, it's just... It's fine. It's great. I would rather never watch the video again, but the song is perfect to me.
Wow. I gave it a 3.5. I thought it was great, but I thought it wasn't a hit.
This is like...
This is a perfect 5
like
on
you
5
don't understand. Track. This is the song that probably got me into Kendrick for real. Like, it's just so well composed to me. Lyrically, like, I would recommend at a later time revisit the song and see how you feel. Like,
I will. I mean, that's what I mean. Like, I've listened to it
wrong.
A few times.
My
but...
initial impressions on even this song, too, is probably like, because it's hard to digest. It's so many sounds. It's so much growth. Like, you don't really expect this level of, it's almost like Rush made rap music.
Oh, boy.
I don't know. What did you guys give it?
I gave it a 5-on-5.
I know what you gave it.
Yeah. Because
Chris gets it. That's also probably because we can both spit most of the track by heart at this point. Like, I didn't really have to read the lyrics to this one. I could just kind of like, I can feel the changes. And I was just vibing. It was a fun song.
Yeah.
Anyway, so at the end of this, though, we get a little skit. And at this point, you know, they tell him to, like, fucking kick a freestyle in the car. So what's the name of the next song?
Backseat Freestyle.
So what's his dream?
All right, let me just jump in here for a quick minute, right? Because
he answers that. I just want to say it.
But I wrote it in my notes, but I forgot to write what the dream actually was.
Well, first of all, this song is ironic, right? Like, this is Kendrick freestyling in the whatever. But it's more taking a take on, like, what... rappers in his area, the kinds of guys who turn into this when they're spitting in the back of the car. This is what the raps are about. This is what they're going on about. All my life, I want, you know, it's like, again, a bit of journalism. It's not actually Kendrick's dream. So what is it? They want money. They want bitches. That's the dream. It's kind of selling.
Right.
like, it's like, you know, Martin had a dream, and this is kind of the meta, this is like what the hood's dream has turned into.
Oh, okay.
And if you look at the entire song with that lens, everything he says makes sense, and it isn't like, why is this song on the album? Because my first thoughts were, why is this song on the album the first time I heard it? You watch the video, and it's got the ass shaking and the cars, and but it really is comparable to a few videos I've seen of rap music out there nowadays.
Yeah. It's so fucking, it's more, I find it funny. I find it very comedic in a way how he subliminally goes after it. And everybody kind of looks at it just like, well, this is what I like. And it's like, you're supposed to, though.
Well, I think that, like, it's like, forget anything else. It's a banger. Like, I can't help it. Goddamn, dude, his flow on this is insane.
The way he flips his flow, he just goes back and forth on it. He's just fucking insane. It's fucking insane.
Unlike a lot of other rappers who might go into these fast, repetitive type things, he really doesn't repeat himself. He just says different things that, like, you're expecting him to be like, goddamn, I feel amazing. Goddamn, I'm in the Matrix is the next line. And you're like, whoa, I wasn't expecting him to jump like that. And it just spirals off and shoots like a fucking Speedy Gonzalez or something. It's really fucking cool. Every fucking verse has a new flow. The beat is banging. Like, you can't everything not be like, Like, look, maybe, like, lyrically it could come off in a bad way, depending on if your girlfriend hears you talking about wifey and mistress and shit. But, like, that's just doesn't take away from how amazing this song
is. But that's like what every rapper wants, though. It's kind of like that dream, like you were saying. This song is very ironic in a way where he's preaching what it is. And it's.
Do you want to hear where the realness, though, comes in? This lyric always stuck out with me from every single time I ever heard it. And her body got that ass that a ruler couldn't measure, and it make me come fast, but I never get embarrassed. And you gotta, like, imagine, all you hear in rap music is dudes who can fuck for hours with megadicks. And, like, when a dude is, like, look, if her ass is that popping and you're about to hit that and you ain't fucked all day, there's a good chance that first shot is going to come quick. That's just biology.
Pun intended.
Now, if you happen to have, you know, created a circumstance where that's not the regular, I kind of feel bad for you, bro. That's all I'm trying to say. Because you know what? You just go for round two if you're really worried about shit.
Just means the lady is very impressive.
Absolutely. And very then go lovely. For round two. That's the key part. Or, like, fingers or something.
And at least, if you're finished, you make sure you take care of her.
Yeah. Otherwise, you're in trouble. Right.
You hear me?
She's right there. But, no, for real, says awkward and gets Axel 23 and shit, for real, this song's a fucking banger. I really, really like it. I give this a... I give it a 4/5, though.
Oh, okay.
Because, like, as a song, I don't want to rap along to this one, right?
I gave it a 5 because I want to rap along to it. I'd rather rap along to this more than Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe, to be real.
Yeah, but, like, Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe is a song I can relate to, and it's interesting, and it's like, right, it kind of describes shit.
But knowing that this song's ironic, it's kind of funny and humorous to me. It's like,
well, I get that, like, because from a technical proficiency, but really, I don't know. There's just something about the irony that makes it a great part of the story to throw in there, a great part of this album.
In a journalism sense,
but
yeah.
Standalone song, it really just kind of does sound like every other hip hop song. And if it just came on alone, I'm not 100% feeling the song. I just love its role on the album.
Right. I gave it a 5. Bonnie?
I gave it a 3. I thought it was good, but, like, I found it just sort of, I don't know, I didn't like it. I didn't like the topic. I didn't like the whole, that his dick would be the Eiffel Tower and would fuck
everybody.
Honestly,
I would love to fuck the world, like, for 72 hours.
No. I don't know. It just wasn't my favorite at all. I don't know. I didn't like the changing of his voice, but I do feel that, like, this could be, like, one of those songs that if I listen to it more, that I would like it more.
It does grow on you.
Yeah. It just didn't seem fitting. That's all.
Play it a couple times, Bonnie. Maybe.
Yeah, I think that, like,
I'll give it another chance.
I think that with the context, it changes the song a bit. And, you know, it's a real central issue on this album.
What?
The art of peer pressure?
That would be it.
Me and my niggas fall deep in a white Toyota. A quarter tank of gas, one pistol, and orange soda. Janky stash box when the Federalis are roll up. Basketball shorts with the Gonzales Park odor.
This song is like a fucking movie.
It's a full-on cinematic.
Yep. Like, I wrote theatrical in the first sentence. The very beginning is, like, Kendrick being all reflective, and the music's a certain way, and, you know.
It's very old school sounding.
He's kind of presenting himself like he's really a good person, you know, but when he's with the homies, he kind of lets things slip, right?
Right. You know, boys will be boys.
Just changes.
Well, he talks about drinking and smoking, but that he's truly a sober soul.
About like fucking Sherane. He's like, I'm going to fuck Sherane and brag about it.
I think It's further down.
Well, that's the outro of the song, yes.
Yeah.
He just gets all fucked up because he went to homies in the first part of the song, right?
Yeah.
Right. So I was wrong. Bonnie was right. Internet heard
ding, ding,
it.
Ding, ding, ding.
But, then the song just changes. So I guess he's all fucked up now, right?
Right.
And they're in the car cruising around with bad intentions and shit.
Bad intentions.
Like, for me, it was
up to no good, those boys.
What really fucked me up is like this part. We pulled up on a bunch of working girls and asked them what they're working with. Look at me. I got the blunt in my mouth. Usually I'm drug free, but shit, I'm with the homies.
Yep.
I like that. That, like, to me is the song right there, and that, those lyrics, right? It just expresses it. It's like saying, look, you are a good kid. And you're with your boys, and the next thing you know, you get a little too fucked up, and the next thing you know, you're in the kind of situation he proceeds to describe. So they start robbing the house.
In a way, it can happen. All right? It can happen to anybody, and it can happen to you.
Not really, maybe not so much, but I think what he's expressing is that in his area where he comes from, this is a reality that happens. Like, this has happened to him more than
I also like to think that it's very possible for that generic scenario to happen. Maybe not rob a house, but to get fucked up with the homies based off of peer pressure. You know, the peer pressure thing is it happens, and it's a real fucking story about what goes on.
Whatever, somebody in the house, and then they break away and they start pulling away, and then there's a left and a right and a left,
and then the cops are the left and a right, and then two rights, and
yeah, and then
his mom calls while they're fucking running. He says his mom calls, but he doesn't pick up, and you know, he's like, he didn't want to tell her he's about to catch a case.
Yeah,
but thankfully they ended up missing it, and I was just like, holy shit, like another one of those fucking, like, can you imagine, like, your mom has no idea. It just stuck out to me. Like, imagine getting the call from your mom
while you're dodging
the cops.
Yeah.
What do you do? Hi, mom. We're totally fine. We're cruising. Everything's good. We're just chilling.
No.
I would.
You don't answer. No, you don't answer.
My mom would murder me if I didn't answer the phone. Hi, mom. What are you doing? We're having a marathon. I'm running. I'm trying to get into shape. Okay, bye.
No, that's not really what would happen if
you're in the back of the car with stolen merchandise.
Well, not if I'm in the back, but if I'm running. Like, Kendrick was running when...
No, he was in the car when the call came, man. And they were running from the cops.
He was in the car.
This is in the police chase where they're in a car being chased down from the cops, no? Because after that...
But they're running
out. No, they're running out of the house. They run out of the house. They run down the aisle, the back alleyways. And he takes a left at one point, and then the cops end up taking a right. But as he's running, his mom calls.
I was just pretty sure they're in a fucking car at that point.
I thought they were in a car. They all busted out of the house, and they all just left.
Yeah, but they had a bunch of stolen merchandise in the car, they said. And then they were driving, and then the cops showed up, and the flashing lights behind them, and that happened. They ran out of the car, robbed a house, put the shit back in the car, got back in the car, and the cops is following them when this happens. Because then it goes into the outro skit where they're in the car kind of talking about their plans and shit, as far as I understand it.
How are we so mixed up about this?
Because it's that deep. There's that many layers to this shit. It's not like...
Kendrick, you did a good job.
It's not a wasted bar, right? No, it is not a wasted bar. Every line of this is like you're watching a movie play out in your fucking head. It's a lot of information to take in, and it's really easy to get caught up on a detail.
But this song is pure.
Anyway, the beat's amazing. The second part's fucking fantastic. It flows into a conversation at the end where now... Kendrick is going to go fuck what's her name? You know,
Sherane.
He's going to go meet up with Sherane. They're going to all reconvene later on in the evening, and they're all parting ways right now. And I get it's a 5. I thought it was
one of the most fucking serious stories.
I don't even know if the song is as great as a 5 should be, but the experience of hearing this is like you can't stop it. You hit play, and the next thing you know, you're hearing the skit at the end, and you can't turn it off in the middle. It just sucks you in.
It's literally like ruining a movie.
Yeah.
It's one of the most perfect experiences on the album.
Oh, wow.
And you?
I just thought it explained a lot about, like, what's going on, you know, and it kind of will go into detail more about, like, what is happening in his life, about peer pressure, and we see that kind of throughout the album. It wasn't my favorite, though. I'm telling you,
wait till the fourth, fifth listen.
I gave it a 3.5.
That's okay.
I thought, like, the first part was cool. I thought that, you know, like, it does show that he's struggling with being violent and, you know, falling into this trap that seems to be just so easy to fall into.
Well, I mean, think about,
so he keeps,
like,
having to, like, make the right decision. And, like, he knows what the right decision is. But, and, like, that's why he's saying that he's a sober soul. He doesn't want to be doing these things, I don't think.
But he's with
but
the
he
homies.
Does it because he has to, and he has to be impressive and cool. But I still think that he's kind of just, like, a nerd. You know, like, I think that he kind
of
is.
Yeah, but that's like, the point. He's the good kid in the mad city.
So, you know, it's hard. He's got to try to fit in, but he's so awkward, I think.
But,
and,
like,
he's so young. He's so darn young right now.
Yes, yes, compared to when Humble
like, when you
dropped.
See him, he's just, like, a kid. He's not even, like, a grown man yet.
He was, like, 25.
I think he was, like, 23.
No.
He didn't look like a man yet. You know, now he looks more like a man.
It was 5 years ago when this came out.
Well, whenever.
I was 25. Anyway, so the next song on the album, folks, is Money Trees featuring J-Rock.
Me and my niggas trying to get it, you bitch. Yeah, bitch. Hit that house, yeah, bitch. Tell me, is you with it, you bitch. Yeah, bitch. Home invasion was persuasive. Was persuasive. Was persuasive. From that.
This song is a bit of a summary.
A little bit.
Yeah.
A little
it's
bit.
It's like, here's what's going on. This is some context, you know. Money's the focus. You know,
yeah.
Ya bitch. Ya bitch. And then J-Rock raps about selling drugs. And then it kind of, that's about what I got from it.
Oh, right. And there's also, like, a verse from Anna Wise. And she was pretty cool.
Yeah, that was a good part of it. And then we get a skit at the end. This is the one with the drunk dad and the fat booty from the fucking, this is my favorite
the
skit.
The dad just wants his damn dominoes back.
No, I don't know. This,
no, he talks about them at the end.
And then the fat booty, oh, what's your booty? Ah. And she knows she's going to be hearing that song all the time now because it was that good to me.
Oh, boy.
And otherwise, it was okay. I don't know. I think the most significant thing in this entire song to me is but the one in front of the gun list forever.
I like that line.
Yep.
I also like what he follows up with it when he goes, a dollar could take your main bitch. I like a
See,
dollar can make.
That's a little more like obvious to me. He's going like, look, the money will change everything in my life. But the part where he specifically goes, look, everybody glorifies the shooter, but it's the one who gets shot that lives forever.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And
I will
actually
never.
Goes a little bit deeper because of his Christian faith. And what he's really saying is at this point, these people are going to heaven and shit, and they're living in their eternal life.
Right.
On top of the fact that there's the fame and shit. And it was like, that was a lot to think about in one lyric that. To a point where more or less the rest of the song's kind of whatever. Da 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 da. Yeah, bitch! And that's all I'm ever really going to care about for, like,
true.
Goes
true.
Halle Berry, who I don't find that hot.
Hallelujah.
Halle Berry, I think you are gorgeous.
That's fine. But, I mean, okay. To me, that was just, like, whatever. This is a great standalone track, don't get me wrong. It has its purpose in life. When you just want something smooth, like, it kind of feels nice. It's a soft middle piece in the middle of this album because you just had so much intensity, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a good, like, whatever.
It's a nice little break.
It's a good 4 on 5 to me.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
The skit was nice, really, for me because the skit was high. No, but really, the song was also good. I didn't hate it. It's just after, like, the Art of Pure Pressure, almost anything that was set to follow this up was probably not going to do as well based on my love of music.
I don't think that. I think that I gave, first of all, I gave this song a 5 on 5 because of the lyric that I was saying. Given my transition of growing up and learning all this shit and making music and starting to really, like, got a better job, I'm making more money, and I'm starting to see my life change and my friends that I had and people that are around me are not around me anymore.
Sorry,
so
that's what I got out of Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe.
Like, it's kind of the same message, really, but I feel like Bitch Don't Kill My Vibe is literally, like, don't run up on what I'm doing,
nah,
like,
man. I
whatever, but
I
this is more like
shit.
No, but he's like seeing what other rappers have done, and he's like trying to maybe not make those same mistakes or like learn
like
lessons from them
song,
or like learn
I
how
feel
to
like
be
it's
successful.
More shallow, right? It's more with money, I can take your girl. With money, this is gonna happen. It's not the same thing. Like it's more like direct. Like if he gets money, he has the power to be rich, and it's kind of from that tone. I'm saying, like, based on your explanation, I'm not agreeing as much.
It's more.
Like, I can see what you're saying.
Well, no, to be real, if we're gonna get a little, just to get a little personal, I think it's more of a paranoia of certain aspects of what he says that I kind of feel when I look out at whether in my life or in other things.
When he's saying this, he's taking it, look, if I get this money, then I have the power to do this.
Right.
Yeah, I think he's also saying at the same time, because I do think that he does, like you kind of get that feeling as well. But I do think that he's also kind of saying that, you know, whether or not he's rich or poor, he's still going to have problems because of money. Yeah. And, you know, like...
I feel like that's not, more conveyed in the verses.
Like, yeah, like, right. not having money is...
And then the
it
hook,
sucks. And then, you know, you end up with all these problems. And then if you're rich, those people are going to steal from you.
And I think at the end of the day, he's just saying everyone's priorities are a little wrong. Because at the end of the day, it's the one in front of the gun who lives forever. I don't know. And if you think...
I think he wants to be a little bit of a martyr. And he is obsessed with death, which he does mention in, like, another song. So, like, this whole kind of, like...
How did you feel rating wise?
I gave it a 4/5 because it's a real story with like real issues, but I don't think it's like my favorite song.
Ah, fair enough. It's a little bit of poetic justice.
Mm-hmm.
Story's back on track, folks. I think this is actually where the story really starts in the album, or maybe maybe Money Trees is really the start. Or I take it, Money Trees is kind of really the real start. He's contextualizing shit. And then Poetic Justice is now, he's describing Sherane.
Yeah.
Right? So this perfect high maintenance, I guess, bad bitch type that he's encountered that he likes.
Bad and bougie bitch type.
He says bougie, yes, he does in the song.
Yeah.
And then,
is he the one that started it?
I doubt it. I think it's just a street term that grew out of whatever.
Okay.
Because it's a bastardization of bourgeois.
That's true.
And so it's kind of like, it's all right. It's definitely a Drake-ish kind of song on this album.
It's more like smooth.
Poetic. It's like, okay. Yeah. And it's like, all right. And it's kind of calling out that, like, you know, there's a certain level of poetic justice because they're kind of not writing about the women so positively. Like, they put them through some stuff, and this is their poetic justice. They wrote this song in such a subliminal, cheeky kind of way or whatever. It's okay, whatever. And Drake, all I can say about Drake is recently on the More Life playlist that we reviewed on Headspace, he pulled a shot at Kendrick in some part about, and if I was still on that conscious rap, I would have like half your fans or some shit like that, right?
Yeah.
And when you hear these two next to each other, I just don't see a Drake, man. Like, you sound hollow next to this dude.
Dude, it's totally over. That's the only reason why I gave this song a 4/5. I was vibing the entire way, and then Dick Tree shows up. And I'm like, oh.
I'm going to say Drake wasn't bad on this song. What I felt is that he was kind of hollow as a person. It's like when I thought about his abilities as a conscious rapper, I realized, look, I'm a conscious rapper because I'm consciously aware of the world around me, and I actively try to learn more. Drake, you can't just be a conscious rapper. You have to live a certain way. Like, you have to have a reason beyond yourself. And I don't see that in this song. Even your verse was a little bit petty and selfish, whereas Kendrick was kind of presenting something. And that's the difference between the two.
Yeah.
And I gave this a 4/5 because, not that Drake was bad. Drake was equally as good as Kendrick to me. I don't actually see
it.
No.
That's exactly what I thought. I thought they were both equally actually good.
Drake's verse bored me.
That's fine, because you are biased against Drake. Yeah.
Regardless.
We can watch a whole review where you said if he's on the song, you're not even going to like it or whatever. So your opinion on that isn't fair, per se. But Drake was equally as good as him. It's just their content was different. And that's what really, whatever, for me. Anyway, 4/5, not a lot more to care about it. It's smooth. No. It's kind of similar to Money Trees. Anything here, Chris? No? Okay. Bonnie, what did you give it?
I gave this song a 3 because I thought it was boring, and yeah, it didn't really do that much for me. It was not my favorite. Yeah.
All right, let's move on to something more stimulating and talk about Good Kid.
Supposed to do when the topic is red or blue, and you understand that I ain't, but no, I'm accustomed to just a couple that look for trouble and live in the street with rank. No better picture to paint than me walking from Bible.
Poetic justice, that's really contextually appropriate.
What?
So the skit at the end is the two guys in the hoodies from the end of the first track, Sherane's thing, appearing, and they beat the fuck out of him.
Yeah.
Right? And so he gets jumped. And that's where Good Kid comes in, and it's the real turning point on the album, like you were saying. Like, it's within itself. this is the song where he's looking around his city for the first time, I think, and realizing he really is just a good kid in his mad city. Things have to change, and he's just trying to, he's coming to, like, terms with the reality that is around him. And a
fucked up reality.
It's fucked. Yep. That's a good way to put it. The tone of his voice is different. He goes from having a certain level of confidence and swagger to a certain almost anxiety that comes through.
Well, like, he really depicts
that,
he really presents and depicts the imagery of him being a child, and that's how a child would act. You would be anxious. You would be
in fear.
You would have fear when you're walking through this type of city.
And you can't even trust the police that you're supposed to be able to trust.
The second verse is dedicated, and he's like, and what are you supposed to do when the red and white, the red and blue behind you or whatever?
If you've got red and, I think if you've got red and blue on your roof.
And then it's like, what you're supposed to do, and they're behind you, and like they're coming, and you know.
And
what
he's coming
happen.
Back from like Bible study, and he gets pinned down, and he's
think,
like,
I think the most significant
like,
thing I was looking at was one of the verses ends where it's like, and they don't care, they don't have respect for the fact that he's a good kid, they don't care, right?
Yeah.
And because in their minds, he's just another gang banging kid from Compton, regardless of who he is, and.
With no proof, with no nothing, they're like, just assuming.
The beat gives you chills, right? Like, it's the perfect fucking tone, and this is a five. Like, I don't even know how to look at it another way. It is the best. Not the best. It's just one of the best on this album. It's so good.
Well, I gave it a four. not that I didn't like it.
Sorry, before we go into that, do you know who does the chorus?
No.
The mass hallucinations and. That's Pharrell Williams from N.E.A.R.D.
Yeah.
For those of you who don't know.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, Chris, you gave it a four because?
I gave it a four simply because I felt it lack a little bit of hype. Even though it's supposed to be this, like, good kid in this fucked up city, I feel like it was too, like, serious in a way. I feel like he could have had
a high level of, because you're not listening to the emotion, man. Because he's suppressed, right? He's anxious. It's not
right.
It's a song of anxiety, right?
Yeah.
And he delivers anxiety almost better than I've ever heard in rap music before. And the way that when the beat gets more intense and he gets even more desperate with it. I don't know. Maybe you need to check it again, bro.
Maybe. I truly agree.
Because there's no, because had he got, because he would have changed the entire emotion of the song if he had done what you were asking.
Right.
I'm not have to just, like, I understand, you can still give it a four and you can still want more out of it, but this was art, right? Like, this isn't just a song.
I don't disagree. Again, maybe I have to re-listen to it, but I felt like, maybe a little bit of rage when there was the intense parts. It was like, okay, like, you're fucking mad.
Because it's not anger, it's desperation.
Right, yeah. Right.
And that's what he's going for in this. And even the beat,
it's not
anger.
It's realness about him having to grow up in this situation. And it just.
Maybe
it
I feel
sucks.
Angry for him.
Yes, yeah. That's what you're supposed to have happen. You're supposed to. This is like. Like, he's being a journalist to, again, kind of like fuck the police and shit came out back in whenever from Compton to say, this is our reality. It's just all the way in the future. This is our reality again. Still, you guys need to understand how fucked up it is to even be the good kid. I don't know. It's fucking great. And you, what did you think?
I gave it a four. I mean, I do think it is great. I think it is, you know, I do think it
but
is
no,
art.
But Bonnie's not going to listen to this every day.
Yeah, I'm not going to listen to it every day. So, I don't know. I mean, like I said, I think it's, you know, it's a very open, honest story about what's going on and how terrible it is. And he's bringing, you know, spotlight on the situation.
It's just like a mad city.
A very mad city. If Pyros and Crips all got along, they probably got me down by the end of the song.
Seem like the whole city go against me. Every time I'm in the street, I hear. So does anyone know what MAD stands for?
Yes.
What does it stand for?
According directly, you know, Kendrick and I were tight and we had a little chit chat.
Clearly.
No. I saw a little video of an interview and it means my angry adolescence divided, and it also means my angels on angel dust.
Yeah.
And he did put the A's on purpose in capital because he wanted to emphasize the angels and angels.
Yeah.
Because as we're going to find out in the story about the angel dust.
Oof, man. So, the story's fucked up, right? Like, so the chorus, the ground down, where you from, that's actually the skit where the two hoodie guys That's what they say to him.
When he pulls up to Sherane.
It's just kind of echoed down and like changed into the song, right? So you get the context.
There's lots of little things that kind of flow together.
Right, but like it presents this context that this is in the middle of like getting beat down and shit. He's in this mad city. This is what's going on. And then he's in the car. This is where his first blunt is laced with cocaine. So he's like, why do you guys think I don't smoke? Imagine if you were foaming at the mouth. And he's presenting all this crazy shit.
And he's like, that's what I was given like the first time. And you know, it really fucked him over.
And then like,
you know, like he didn't want to do that.
And then like the beat just keeps evolving in such cool ways to fit the intensity of the story.
Dude, it's insane. It's like this big fucking roller coaster of just epicness.
Everything.
This is the one where it's like his friend kills somebody and he's like, I'm not saying he did it, but I look at him different now. And like stuff like that happens. And I think the most striking, then the MC8 shows up, and I guess he's like the old school G is what I felt.
You heard like that kind of like wicka wicka a bit more, like, and so it had that, it like had everything.
Everything.
Then it was that lyric, if I told you I killed at 16, would you believe me? Or see me to be innocent Kendrick you see in the streets playing basketball and shit. And it was like, oh, that's fucked up, right? Because then you look at him a little bit, and even for a half second, you're like, did Kendrick kill someone?
Did Kendrick catch a body?
Like, because that's the whole point. It's like, it's these little good kids locked into mad cities, pressured into these things where, yeah, you have a crazy night where you smoke a joint, and next thing you know, you kill someone, and then you're done. You're fucked. And that's the mad city you're in. And with you consider the context put together, you're horny, you want this girl, there's gangs involved, and you're getting jumped.
He's so scared of the gangs that he's going to get, you know, he's going to get sucked either into them or he's going to get killed by them.
And then keep in mind, because if Pyros and Crips actually got along, they just gun him down by the end of the song, right?
Yep.
And it seems like the whole city go against him.
Well, they keep referring to, you know, all this violence and, like, the fact that people are just dying and that there's just all this crime that happens and drugs and whatever else. And they just say, oh, it's just a Compton thing. They're just going to brush it off and they're like, oh, whatever, they'll deal with it. So we've got that same situation is still happening, like, 20, 30 years later.
There's also, like, a duplicity in the fact that we know he's a good kid trying to get out and trying to change shit and being in this mad city, seeing everyone else being like this and knowing that they know that, like, I think he says some line on how he could be prey or something at one point. Like, this song is insanity.
It's a lot of back and forth of subjects.
This is the first 6-on-5 I think I've had to give on the entire fucking thing, but there's very few songs I've ever heard like this, and it's better than a 5, but it's a 5 for the sake of whatever. But
straight 5.
It is remarkable and shit.
It has everything.
Like everything you want in a song, it is in this song.
If there was one song on the album to see the artistic brilliance of Kendrick Lamar, not to say that there aren't better songs per se for song, but the artistic brilliance of what this guy brings to the table is Mad City, more than anything else. It's like 6 minutes, and a lot of these songs push that, actually, and you don't feel them ever.
No.
You're like hit the 5-minute point, you don't even realize it. You're like, fuck it, man, 4 verses of pure gold with that crazy. And now that I know that that hook is part of the skit on the song, which I never even made the connection before, right?
And you just feel like his pain, like that, you know, like he's just such a struggle that he's going through, but you know,
it's
he has
good,
to.
Man.
I don't know. It's
so,
just,
and then he goes on and describes in the next song what a lot of people do with that pain. You know, they dive into swimming pools while they drink. They grew up around some people living their lives in bottles. All right, this song's fucking great. This is the banger. I think this is what really blew Kendrick over the top back when I remember.
So
well,
this
was the number
song.
One song. This was
is the only song that I had, like, heard in passing.
This is that, like, song where the first time you hear it, you think it's one thing, and then you realize what it is as time and it sinks in, and you're like,
and then you listen to it every day, and you're like, this is such a good song.
And you're like, listen, your conscience is inside of you, Kendrick, and he's trying to keep you afloat. Fuck, we all know what it's about. Peer pressure, drinking, how, like, he presents context. Some people do it for me. Me, I got pressured into drinking because I had to be cool. And then, you know, he took, like, he was drinking his little drink, and he's like, let me show you how to turn it up a notch.
How it's really done.
Got a swimming pool full of liquor, and
then
they'll
dive in
it and watch how the girls will play Baywatch with us if we have all the alcohol flow. And it's true. Like, for real, this, like, whole context, it's like I know a lot of people, they go to the club, they pop all the bottles, all the girls come over and play Baywatch, and it works, and it creates this kind of dynamic of alcohol.
They come flocking.
And
that's what he says.
It's like everybody drinks to be cool. And recently in my life, I've cut back a lot on drinking.
So have I, actually.
I drink when I perform and when I go out. but I also don't go out a lot, so I barely drink. And yeah. I don't know. I get where he's coming from. I was peer pressured multiple times into some dumbass shit like that when I was younger, and even in my 20s and shit. Like, it's not really like it ends. You're still like, I'm at work now. And we have, like, Sanka sets and shit that happen.
Oh, yeah.
And you get peer pressured. Yo, come to it. Come to us. Get drunk. And you're like, this is a work event. And I've been in trouble for accidents that have happened at work events while I'm drinking. It's not an excuse, right? And I get it. This song's beautifully constructed and composed. And it's I never heard the extended version before.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the ending was
different,
it.
Actually.
And,
you get a whole, like, extra verse, and then you get, like, a skit.
Well, I think the skit was probably in the album before, in light of what it is.
Well, it's just not on, like, the regular song.
Well, it's not on the single, right? Because of what happened. So, the skit is, Kendrick's been beat down. So, this whole song and the story is when they've met up again after he goes to meet Sherane, and they were planning on meeting up around, what, 10 or midnight?
I thought it seemed like a right. hallucination almost, like, when he was, like, talking to, like, Sherane. It just felt, like, so surreal, like, this, like, memory of her.
Well, maybe.
That's cool.
But, like, I feel like...
Like, because he was so drunk. Like, for me, like, that's kind of, like
in
what...
this song?
Like, yeah.
Oh, well, at this point, he's getting drunk from what... Because keep in mind, he just got the shit kicked out of him, right? In, like, Maad City and stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And now he met up with his crew like he was supposed to. Because earlier in one of the skits, they talk about, like, after they robbed the house, they're like,
gonna
look,
meet up.
We're going to meet up again after. So now we're here... And they get drunk.
It's crazy. It's like everything just
boys,
kind of like
right?
interloops with
so
like
he's
other
like,
things.
He's with his people. He gets fucked up with them. He drinks, etc. And then they go out and they decide to go like run up on those gangbangers who beat the fuck out of Kendrick. And you hear some gunfire. But it turns out that Dave, one of
his
Kendrick's
brother.
Crew, or the other guy, not Kendrick. Kendrick was the friend of Dave and it was like the older brother. He was crying out then. And so Dave, the Kendrick's friend, dies in Kendrick's arms. And, yeah, at that point, I just, like, stopped, and I was like, shit got real.
Shit
yeah.
got real real quick.
Like,
yeah.
it is possibly the biggest pinnacle moment of the story part of the album. It's like, this is it. There's a death now in their crew because of their shenanigans. And up until this point, look, they're getting fucked up. They're drinking. It's a lot of shenanigans, right? Even though Kendrick is aware of it, he's still participating
right.
in the shenanigans. He's still a little bit of a hooligan in his behavior. He's just a good kid, right?
Yeah.
And then shit changed.
No, but David is his brother.
It's not Kendrick's brother. It's, no, I'm 100% sure. I, like, fucking looked into this a little bit just before this, right? So the guy who's talking at the end who says they shot my brother, that's not mm-hmm. Kendrick. That's one of the bleeped out names. And he, because in one of the other songs he references how, in the next one when we get there, it's actually the brother talking to Kendrick at first. And one of the things he says is how he sees Kendrick holding his brother. So, no, it's not. Kendrick is the friend of the little brother. Like, they're the same age. And this is the older brother that was with him
oh,
and shit.
Oh, okay.
And 100% on that. And, yeah, it was just fucked up, right? And I don't know. I don't have a lot more to say on Swimming Pools. It's a 5, obviously.
No,
yeah.
The song itself is a 5. It's really fucking... I've always thought it was deep just because... I took the aspect of drowning your problems in alcohol and just, like, forgetting and trying to party the night away, right?
Yep.
But knowing after hearing the deluxe edition, you're kind of just like, wow. Shit got real, real fucking quick, and now
I feel
it's
like
serious.
This
like,
is a better song on Peer Pressure than the art on Peer Pressure for me.
Right.
Like, when I first
right.
heard it, that was my thoughts. Like, I guess even at this time, back in 2012.
Well, it just, like, shows what, like, everything just leads to. It just,
right.
it leads to death.
Right.
Like, if you just don't stand up and say, like, this is wrong. Like, we shouldn't be doing this. Like, you know, it shouldn't just be, like, this continuous, you know, fighting. And then he does say that this is what life is like in Compton. And it sucks. Like, you know, it really sucks to be, right. like, in that situation where people are just dying all the time. And
did
these are people that you know.
Did you also think it was a 5?
Yes, I did.
That's cool. I'm glad that we are united in this.
United
this song is really deep. Honestly, like...
What do you think of the music video?
Yeah. Let's be real. I've liked one of Kendrick. I didn't like any of the music videos off of this. I was a Pimp a Butterfly. He got a budget. His videos got cool.
Yeah.
This is still kind of like the beginnings and a little bit of, like, it's good. It fits the song. It's not, like, out of place. It's just not good.
Yeah. He's so young. That's all.
Anyway, sing about me because I'm dying of thirst.
Hands on the wheel. Who said we wasn't? Dying of thirst. Dying of thirst. Dying of thirst. Dope on the corner. Look at the car.
Okay, I saw 12 minutes and change, and I was like, fuck my life.
Yeah, dude, I was, yeah. Oh my God.
And then it started.
This.
And
this is a journey and a half.
So the first two verses are actually Dave's brother talking to Kendrick. And then in the first part, right? Because this is a slash song, but it's not. It's an experience. So
it's a two-part song.
Right, which is a slash song. And it's just well executed, okay?
For those who don't know what a slash song is.
Everybody knows a song of the slash. Okay, so like the whole first, and it's got this tone, and it's really like calm and stuff. And like it's just so. And
very
like,
serious.
Like, I'm having trouble even expressing it. It's just emotional, right? You get really, and it's just so reflective, right? Because keep in mind, he just died. And now they're thinking about it, right?
Yeah.
And then Kendrick is the third verse, speaking as himself. He's kind of reflecting on everything that just happened, right? Yeah. And then it kind of cuts in the middle, and there's another skit. And it's them kind of talking like, yo, he just died. He just fucking died. You can hear phone calls happening.
And then they're like, no, we can go get him. We can go get them. Like, they're going to go kill the guys that just
and
killed this guy.
And then he just fucking, like, freaks out and says, I'm tired of this shit. Like, the brother.
He just wants it to stop.
Like, yeah, this is the guy who just lost his brother freaking out like that. And you can just hear, it's almost panic in his voice. Like, it just goes to a next level of anything. And then a whole new song starts.
I still feel like it's his brother.
It's not.
Okay.
And, the whole new song, and then the beat's so fucking groovy and, like, interesting, and Kendrick's just like, we're all dying of thirst, because, look, in the first song, Sing About Me, because they want, you know, it's like singing about the memory
well,
of the song.
Well, it's very much, I found, at least, the first part was very much about him and his friends being able to leave behind a legacy.
Okay.
Yeah.
And, like, that they wanted to, like, make something of their lives, and that they wanted to make sure that they were remembered, even though that, you know, they maybe didn't succeed or whatever. Like, they still want to make sure that their
it's
stories
like it wasn't
and that
all
their
for
names
nothing.
Are told. Well,
look, it wasn't all
at
for nothing,
the,
right?
At the end of the first verse, right? So it's kind of him talking to Kendrick. I just checked my notes again. I have a bit more. So, and it's like he wants it to be like, look, don't let this story go to waste.
Yeah.
Is kind of the point. And he actually goes, he's at the end of the verse, he's kind of going on a bit like, listen, and make sure you write about this, and if I die before your album drop, I hope, and he just
and
gets,
he gets
killed,
shot.
Right? And then the second verse is referencing a Kendrick song from his last album about this same guy's sister who was a...
Kesha's
song or something like that. She was a prostitute and didn't go get checked. She refused to go see the doctor,
and
right?
She might have died, maybe, from,
no,
like,
she
HIV.
Did die. She died of some kind of something, right? And
yeah.
The one there in this verse, a doctor's approval is a waste of time. I know I'm straight, right? Like, you know, and that's an actual thing, right? That's a real thing. So these people get clipped on AIDS or shit like that. So that happened.
So that's
and
still
again,
happening because, as we remember, Eazy-E also died of HIV, and that was in 1990.
I also wrote a video about condoms, and you can check
and
it out
they
on the channel.
Yeah, in one of the songs, he does reference condom use. But I
condom
think,
rappers.
Yeah.
No, but, like, for
so,
real.
So, I mean, it's a real thing that, like,
and it
that
kind
this
of,
area isn't being taken care of.
But
and
I,
it, like,
I just
want
to state, I think
of,
he uses condom rappers to reference the fact that they're soft safety rappers. They're not edgy and taking risks. I just
yeah, I just think that it's a new generation, and now they're concerned about
this. No, I think Chris
this.
Is right.
Anyways,
I
took it literally.
Okay, and then I think it's just also sing about it, right? Like, when these things do happen and you know about the story, don't let it go to waste. That's why one of the biggest inspirations for me as an artist has been those stories
something.
That I've heard that are just like, you
Kendrick
can't believe
Kendrick performs
it.
And presents stories in a way that really makes you feel like you are sitting right there with it. It is...
And then, like, the third verse is Kendrick just kind of responding in his own thoughts. And then it flips into the whole other song, and it's, like, it's really amazing. It's, like, desperation from the hood. They're all thirsty, and I guess, like, I understand that. Like, I like to call it starving, but, like, when I look around and I see where, like, a lot of poor people come from, a lot of this area, when you are part of that neglected group of society, you just can't succeed. No matter what, your plan is this the one with the plan A, B, and C, or am I no, okay, I'm wrong. But that idea can be translated into a lot of what I felt there.
Right.
But like in this one, he's just talking about how he's just so sick of you know, all this crime and all this bad, all these bad things that just keep happening. And so he just wants it to stop. He's just sick of being sinful. He wants to be forgiven. He's kind of repenting a bit. And, you know, and then him and his friends, they go to this neighbor lady who starts kind of blessing them and like reciting a prayer with them. And fun fact, that voice is actually Maya Angelou.
I don't know who that is. Okay.
No. And I'll tell you later. If you don't know who she is, you need to be looking her up.
I will do that because that's part of this podcast.
So Maya Angelou.
Okay, we're going to do it. You live with me. You'll tell me after. I think it's worth noting, that they go into this, like, accepting of Jesus speech, showing that they're ready to repent and change their lives, right? I mean, that's the whole point of when you accept Christ, dude. When you go through that little thing, it's to acknowledge that your sins are now washed away. Whatever you've gone through previously, it doesn't matter
anymore.
That's
why they're thirsty. They're thirsty for, like, that baptism, for holy water.
For peace.
But that's, like, the whole basic premise of what Christianity is supposed to be.
Yeah.
Not what people call it in religion. I read the Bible. I know what it actually says. But what's super fucking fascinating about this little piece here is if you cut back to the very first song on this album, it's just cool. Their part of it without the old lady talking. And it kind of sets a tone for the song, right? Like almost like a full circle of the picture of what's happened here.
Like a foreshadowing.
And then when we get into the next track, which we're not going to do now, it kind of is more like we're moving into a new time frame in the story. And it's fascinating. I gave this a 4.5 on 5. I don't know that I could ever really, like it's kind of hard to listen to the whole thing. And based on, like, perfection, it's a truly artistic thing. But it kind of, the first part wasn't as nice as the second part, right?
Yeah.
And the first part kind of went on a little bit very comparably. The second part was blah, like, perfect 5. But the first part was a 4, so I kind of put it in the middle.
So it should be a 4.5.
That's what I said.
Oh, okay. All right, never mind. I thought it was just a
4. I gave it a 4. I agree with everything you say. This song is fucking deep and the meaning behind it is insane. I just felt like literally the only thing I have to say about it is that it was long.
I mean, it is a long song. I gave it a 5 on 5 because, I mean, I just thought I was hesitant about going into this song as well, thinking, I'm like, oh my gosh, it's going to be so long. But it didn't drag on, I didn't find. The second part really is, like, amazing. The first part is a little bit repetitive. It's kind of the same thing over and over.
But, like, it's a good story.
Yeah, I mean, and it takes you through so much. And it really is, like, a real voyage with him. So, yeah, enjoy it.
What'd you give it?
5 on 5.
Okay, perfect. And the next song is Real.
Real.
I'm real.
Now the album changes, right? Like, now after everything, he's starting to come to terms with how to deal. And it's just accepting that you're real. You are you. You are always going to be yourself. And
you got to stay true.
Yeah.
This is something I'm kind of realizing in my life, right? The world wants you to be a certain way.
You have to just be yourself.
Considering the peer pressure. Look, corporate America is the same thing. Your friends are the same. Everybody kind of wants you to be a certain way. All they try to do is tell you how to live. And what Kendrick's, I feel, saying here is, in light of everything this motherfucker just went through, just be real, be yourself. And if you do that, it's going to change. And it's so happy.
Well,
it's
so refreshing. Well, that's what the last thing that the neighbor lady says in the last song. She says, you know, she just says, just be real. And so that's what he's taking from that. And, like, you can tell that he's, you know, he is changed after that. Like, he went through a baptism. He did change. He decided that he was going to be more godly and be more in touch with himself. And this is kind of the beginning of his self-discovery and, like, the path that he wants to take.
And, like, I just feel like it's happier. Like, you feel relief in this song. Honestly, when I got here on the album, I just felt happier. I started bopping around.
The first song, first part of the song is so, like, so nice to listen to. It's so fun. Like, you just want to, like, you can't not dance around to it. It's just fun.
I mean, it's happy and it's great. It's
lyrically fucking wicked.
I got annoyed by the chorus. Just I loved it.
I was like, hey,
you're real. Like, we get it.
I don't think you do get it, actually. Because if you're saying that, I don't think you get it.
Why?
Because he's not saying he's real in that kind of way. Like, it's not that. He's saying, I'm myself. And it's like if you looked just jump ahead to Pimp a Butterfly. It's the same premise mm-hmm. of the song I. It's saying, I'm real. I'm a real person. I'm a real this. I'm actually really, really real. In light of this story, that's a thing, right? He's been invalidated. He's been beaten down. He's lost his friend. Okay. This is like his victory. This is like,
yeah.
I'm real. Like, I'm really here. Mm-hmm. I'm really doing this. And it's so beautiful to me. I just, this isn't arrogance. This isn't that. It's like hope. Almost.
Okay, I can see that. I can see that.
I get, and it's 7 minutes, and I fucking danced. I literally got up and started. You can ask her. I got up and started dancing. It was so good.
Yeah.
And like your head just starts going like that in the middle of this album, and it's such a, it's like an oasis almost. I get this a 5. It is such a beautiful, perfect fucking jam.
Yeah. Mm.
I gave it a 4.
Oh, really?
It's fine. It's you don't have to have great taste. You just have to give a rating.
Right.
Like, I don't have a lot to say. This, we know this has been a longer one, but fuck, it's this album. So I'm willing to jump on to the next one. What do you think?
No. Okay. Fine. So I really loved this song. It was so fun to listen to at the beginning. You know, it was really great. It's all about, you know, he's kind of like saying this message, like, how can you, you know, you have to love yourself, you know, so like just be better, because what's love got to do with anything if you're not loving yourself first and foremost? And that's what he's trying to like express and like get across, and like that's what's going to make people a lot better. And that like someone, like one of his friends tells him that God is what's real. And so like he's very much he keeps taking on this like Christian message throughout this like entire album. And then the guy, whoever he's talking to, and says something about that God is real. He tells him to take care of your mama. And then you hear this like message at the end from his mom, and
oh right, I forgot about that.
Yeah, yes. There's like message from his mom, and I don't know if it's like an actual saved message,
okay, or if it's just like a remade message. Because there's also the message from his dad that was like before the one from his mom, where he was like, "I'm sorry you lost your friend. You know, be a man. Being a man is not about revenge. It's about responsibility and shit like that." And
right.
I forgot about that.
Yeah. And then, anyways, so then his mom leaves this, like,
that part, you know,
just amazing message. And it's, like, so incredible and, like, so inspiring. And, like, I bawled my eyes out when I heard it. And, I mean, it was so nice. And then he's living by her words. Like, you can tell that he's taking her seriously. And he's, like, this is what is going to make me real. He's like, this is what I need to do, and this is what my goals are. And so I thought that it was just wonderful.
All right.
Good job.
Awesome. And that leads us to the last song on the actual original release of the album. So we're going to call it the end of the story. It's Compton. No city quite like mine.
So come and visit the tire screeching ambulance policeman. Won't you spend a weekend on Rosecrans, nigga? Khaki.
This song is interesting. Bonnie just says she didn't have a lot to say, so fuck it. I'm going to start talking.
Okay, go.
So when Kendrick met Dr. Dre, he wrote this song. This is like the only song on the album that was actually new material from when they started working on it, right?
Okay.
Wrote it, recorded it. That like first studio session was in fact Compton featuring Dr. Dre, right? And so he decided to put it at the end of the album, because for all terms and purposes, this is the beginning of his new life, representing Compton with Dr. Dre. It's the pinnacle, it's the crux. It's like everything in this entire story is led up to this moment where he begins anew, and he's achieved that redemption, which is where the Christian themes come from, the redemption mm-hmm. side of it. And he's done it. He was real, and now he's with Dre, literally bashing out Compton, and like,
pretty incredible.
And
he achieved what he aimed for.
And it's very Eminem and Dr. Dre style, I find.
Right.
It's pretty fucking cool. It goes on. It's very much like, well, Dre's kind of the same as always, and a little better because Kendrick wrote the verse this time, I think.
I was excited that Dre was featured.
I kind of knew it was coming. But it was a good song. I fucking really think it's well constructed. It's really fun. It's a great way to end this album. It's happy. It's like a happy side. It's like after everything, the beautiful Compton, right? Like, you just saw all the darkness, and all they're talking about is how amazing fucking Compton is, how much
and
they
love
it.
He's telling you, right, like, come and stay with us for a week and see what life is like here.
And it's the perfect way to end this song, album, the original album, at least.
Yeah.
So 5 on 5, I fucking think it's the best place
on
the album.
It's like, this is what happens in the dark sides But other than that, it's not a bad place.
Yeah. No, but go one step further with it. So if the whole point of this was to create change, right?
Right.
He's saying you saw this perception of Compton that he's presented to you, and that's all people ever see. But here's a whole other side of Compton right. that you need to see.
Yeah.
And this is the end. This is the beginning of the new journey, this new Compton. And I fucking think it's almost prophetic. I mean, he ended up getting in the key to the city and a few other things.
Yeah.
And 5 on 5, like, what else can I say about it?
5 on 5.
I gave it a 4 on 5. I just thought it was good. I didn't think it was my favorite, though, even though I love Dre.
Fair enough. So let's go on to the bonus tracks. The first one's actually the first single off the album, weirdly enough, even though it's not on the album. It's called The Recipe, featuring
Dr. Dre.
Oh, that's still everybody got a build for that. Me, I make meals off that. How the fuck y'all can't see I ride when I drive down the block and you look outside. H-A-T-E in your eyes.
This is The Recipe. That people come to California for women, weed, and weather?
Yes, that makes a shit ton of sense.
But I thought they went there more for fame. And maybe wine? He should have thrown wine.
No, he's talking about why the famous people come to California. Come on.
Well, yeah.
People go to L.A. for fame. People go to Cali for the women, the weed, and the weather. Think about it. You think of Cali, you think of great weed. You think of girls in bikinis because of the sun. That's what you think of. That's what he's presenting.
I guess.
And then he's
lots
like,
of silicone.
Kendrick's saying he's like the king of the city, right? Like he's saying he's the man. He's like, look, I run this shit. If you need something, holla at me. Dre's like, yeah, I validate. And because that was Dre.
Yeah, like, I validate.
Well, come on. Dre just kind of talks half as fast as Kendrick in the best case. And, you know, he's not hating Dre. It's Dre. I like Dre.
Right.
This song is cool. I knew this song, like, as a single for a long time. I actually thought it was on the album, so I was a little surprised to see it was a bonus track. It's actually what made me kind of want to do these bonus tracks, was just to talk about The Recipe. And so here we are. The beat's great. It's smooth. It feels like a summer jam. It's a great single.
Yeah.
It doesn't fit the album.
No. I mean, I listened to it, and I was just like, what is this song about? It's just about people coming to California.
What's about how, like, Kendrick has like the connections now and the know-how? He's got the recipe. He can set you up. He knows what you need.
I guess.
So he's like, he's credible. He's got that. Like, I think that's what he was going. Anyway, 5 on 5 for me. I fucking really like this song a lot.
4 on 5.
This is like a jam, right? This is like
I felt a little bit like
I wouldn't listen to this.
I kind of just felt like you could do that anywhere. I mean, maybe not here because it's winter and it sucks, but you can practically just do it in the summer.
Man, it's nothing like Cali.
Right, totally. It's nothing like Cali, but it's just another connections for what you want. I'm cool.
Nah, it's not. It's doper than that. It's like an upfront, like, flossing where they are song. Anyway.
It's not a bad track. It's really good. Just
fuck it. Okay.
I gave it a 3.5.
See? Hate on this.
I'm not hating anymore. We'll just talk about Black Boy Fly.
Okay.
I used to be. Hold on. Earlier in this podcast, y'all talked about being jealous. And I'm jealous of Kendrick the way Kendrick was jealous of these local Compton dudes coming in here and changing it. That basketball guy in The Game is in the second verse. Everybody knows The Game.
Yeah. I hope I'm saying his name
right. I never heard his name before, really. But yeah, and The Game's huge. He was Compton's next big thing that came out in like 2004. And in 2004, that guy was playing basketball. Kendrick was, we were in grade 10, Kendrick and I. So this was obviously a reality as he was like, or maybe 11. I don't know. And so Kendrick is just talking about how he was jealous of these heroes. Not necessarily, like, he wanted it so badly it made it hurt. And I get that, right? Because what Kendrick's doing with his platform to try to make a difference is exactly what I would love to do with my platform. It's probably
and what
I
his mom
it.
Told him to do.
And, well, yeah, my mom did tell me to do shit like that, too. So,
yep.
Good on you, mommy.
Good job, mommy.
And, but no, this song was really cool for me. And then the fact that the third verse, he is achieving his dreams, and he is now that guy.
He is the Black Boy Fly.
And I would like to just also be on that squad. I mean, granted, I'm not black, but I would like to be a white boy fly. That's all I'm trying to say. Like,
pretty fly for a white boy.
Look, I like this song a lot. Granted, as a song, it's a little drier. I give it a 4 on 5, but I felt it. Like, I felt it deeply.
I feel like this was like a case where like the songs kind of started all sounding the same
blender
for
effect.
Me. So like I had that kind of like it didn't stand out. It didn't really do anything. it's sort of just a song dedicated to the game, and like that he's so thankful that
it's,
you know,
not
that,
just the game
that Compton has allowed them.
The first verse is about the basketball guy.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Also to
so
him.
So there's two guys.
But the other guy who see
he's
the
a
game.
I don't watch. Yeah, but
anyways, the game and the other guy to people in his life. Anyways,
from Compton.
So he's just so thankful that, you know, people didn't think that like all these, you know, people who have like great voices and are telling like these great stories like through rap, and through their art are coming out of Compton, and he didn't think that there would be room for him as well. And so he's so thankful that, you know, that the world is allowing him, even though America still has its struggle with hip hop, that they're still allowing him to come out and,
well, let's just say,
and be from Compton and be successful.
Kendrick done changed some shit.
Yeah.
And I didn't really like this one as much because I'm a Chris Chrome. I remember. And what'd you give it?
I gave it a 4/5.
I knew it. I should have just ran with it.
Well, I gave it a 3/5.
I gave it a 4. It's not fantastic. It's cool.
I gave it a 4/5 because I can actually relate to this, seeing other people that I want to kind of be like, maybe not like gangsters or whatnot, but like kind of looking up to somebody. I felt like he was looking up to these people to want to be like them, and that's how I feel too. Like, I can relate to looking up and being like, this is what I want to do. This is how I have to do it. This is what I got to do. And it's really yeah, very touching in some ways when you really look past the, I guess, maybe literal part of it.
I think that you're actually getting the point of the song. I think there that you just described the song. You said, like, we felt the similar things. Okay, finally, there's one more.
It's now or never, okay? Let's go.
Waking up in a dream, sleepwalking on another big stage. You never heard peace till you hear people scream. Your name and your son, I'm so far away from the place I used to be.
I'm not gonna lie, when I saw Mary J. Blige, I got a little nervous. I knew what that meant, and it's not 100% my cup of tea, but boy, was I fucking wrong.
Excellent.
I really enjoyed this song. It was, again, it's so uplifting, right? Like, it's, again, appreciation. It's so, like, after that hellish ride I just went through, it's like my soul needed to hear Mary J. Blige's upbeat singing.
Yes. Okay. Yes. This song was so good. I loved it. I was so excited when I heard her.
So excited.
I was like, yes, she Mary wrote, J. Blige.
Yes,
woo-hoo.
On
and,
her
like,
paper.
Like, I've got happy faces. I've got all kinds of things. I thought that they made a great, like, duet match. It sounded so good. Like, this was absolutely my favorite song on the album, I think. Mm-hmm. Like, at least one of them.
Okay.
And
this is definitely a B-side for a reason.
Yeah.
I mean, I thought it was such a nice way.
No, it's good.
It's basically like singing about his successes that he's having now, and he's just saying, like, you know, it's sort of like a reminder song and for him to, like, because he is trying to be humble, but at the same time, he's still saying, like, you're having all these chances and opportunities given to you. Like, use them and use them well.
Yeah.
And, like, he's like, it's now or never. And he's like, no matter what, like, this is your chance. And so he's just, like, grabbing that opportunity. And I think it's a great way to end the album.
I think it's a great way to end the deluxe album.
Mm-hmm.
I think Compton is a better
right.
way to end the album.
I totally
agree.
Like,
I give this a 4.5/5. Because truly, it was so well composed and uplifting and shit. It's just, I could not
I
listen to this every day. Like, this was uplifting. So
it was so good.
Like,
I
have to be in a mood for that kind of shit. But it was good.
I gave it a 4/5. Honestly, there's... No, it's just by the time this came, I was done. I was literally
keep
done.
Keep in mind, this is a
like,
long. Like, there is
like
long
I was
there's
done.
A disc
I'm not,
2 on Spotify.
I'm not trying to be a dick. It's just fuck. Like, don't forget, there's a 12-minute song in the middle of this album.
It's
so
cool. And then it's followed by a 7-minute song.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's
okay. We got it. All right. So I'm sure they're going, we've been listening to you guys for this fucking long. Also, we get it. This is not
yeah,
right.
I hope so. So I gave 2 album ratings.
Yep.
I gave 1 for the actual album and 1 for the deluxe edition. Only because the deluxe edition got a bit of a lower grade for me. So I gave 4.7
Ooh.
For
wow.
like the actual album. I had almost no flaws at all on this album. It was
That's
more
crazy.
Like stuff was just not my interest. This is this is a fucking Picasso of fucking, like, this is...
It is.
This is a true masterpiece of music that, like, I wish I could write an album half as good as this one day. Like, that's how I feel when I hear it. And, like, the bonus album brought it to a 4.6.
That's okay. Still a pretty damn good mark.
Yeah.
I gave it a 4.0, which, as you know, for me, is, like, that's pretty good.
Second time that's happened, though.
Like, that's, like, wow. She's really... I'm really rating it a classic.
She made it a classic. And you?
Yeah.
I gave it a 4.4 on the real album. I have to agree with Holden. I was kind of like, there's a very
you didn't
few
agree
flaws.
With me. I gave it a 4.7.
No, you gave it a 4.7, but I'm agreeing with you that
so
there's very
I
few flaws, except for my weird things. I will admit to that. Yes. But
it went down to a 4.3.
Let him say it.
Thank you, Holden. It went down to a 4.3.
He was having trouble speaking, people. You could see
he was helping. He was helping. That's right. But you know what? That is. It for Classic Quest today.
Well, it's kind of almost it. Like we said, just to reaffirm it to the people, next week we're going to do Snoop Doggy Dogg's Doggy Style. And because this
excited.
Is our first request, it just goes to show if you have requests.
Yeah, so thank you for
within,
that request, by the way.
If it's within the realms, we're going to try to hook you up like with other requests and such.
Fill our list up. Let's
just
go.
Keep in mind that if it's a random local rapper that isn't really huge, we might make a show about that one day. We're trying to stick within the realms of actually like well-received classics and shit.
Yeah. Has to be on like some sort of list.
So if you like this, like it, share and subscribe, and you can tweet at us. Well, can ask her to go on Twitter. In the comment box below.
Do it!
Let Chris Chrome know that he needs to get his knowledge on.
Seriously, you need to drop that. Okay, bye!
And then add it into the comments because he said I could do it, so I'm going to keep doing it until someone does. That's what he said.
I did. I'll have to admit,
so
I did
I'm
say that.
I'm just being real. I'm playing by the rules, and it's been fun. I really enjoyed this episode.
Okay, Holden, it's time to go. All right, bye, guys. Okay, bye!